Does anybody have a guitar pick?
We used to bag on the 80s a lot when we were actually in them. I think that was why Guns N' Roses was what it was because we were so sort of the antithesis of what everybody in the 80s was about. But at the same time, I look back on it and go, you know, at least people were having a good time, because most of my peers or colleagues or whatever you want to, most of them are miserable, and all the bands are miserable and all the music's miserable. And it's sort of like, you know, you look at certain periods in time and go, you know, it really sounded like it was inspired, and that people were really enjoying themselves, which I think is sort of lost these days.
A 360 publishing deal basically entitles the record label to take part in revenues from merchandising, publishing, management, endorsements, even film, television, and commercials that the artist takes part in. Traditionally, that wasn't the case. You know, in the old days, the record labels would only participate in revenue from record sales, CDs, vinyls, cassettes, things like that. And the merchandising, like the selling of t-shirts or hats with the artist's image on it, the artist kept that for himself. Publishing, the artist kept for himself. Other types of merchandising or endorsements, the artist kept that for himself. The artist had separate management, okay? But these days, because of various reasons, some of those reasons being the digital application for music, the lack of artist development on part of the larger record labels, digital piracy, all of these things have sort of come together to create a new paradigm in the record, in the music business, and particularly with record labels. So now a label will step in and they'll say, okay, not only do we want to sell your records and you're going to make 15 or 20% off records, but we as the label also want to share in if you get a TV deal, or if you sign a commercial deal, or you decide you want to sell belts or shirts, things like that. Also with your publishing, you know, in the days of yore, a record company would not share in your mechanical rights or your publishing rights. These are the rights if you're a writer. Many artists are writers as well as songwriters, as well as singers or rappers. If that artist wrote a song, well, that artist would get all that revenue from the publishing or mechanical rights. Now the record companies want to share in that. So a 360 deal for a new artist, again, is sort of an all-encompassing deal, whereas a record label is not just pushing record sales or CD sales, but they're pushing the artist's entire brand, or that artist's product. Basically, that's what a 360 deal is for a new artist.
If you take money from the label, they're gonna fucking make you pay it back double. And yeah, maybe a few bands can get away with it with a damn good lawyer, but in the end, I just don't trust it. It's do it yourself, maintain it yourself as much as you can, because once you start dealing with the corporations, man, they don't give a fuck about you.
Well, as somebody who scrounges a living off of being a songwriter, considering people who download it for free off the internet under the guise of sharing, I would say, how do they feel about sharing their car with me, or their house, or their girlfriend?
Like I'm done, dude. that, you know, would I like the old deals back in the 1990s? Yeah, I would, but they're not coming back. So a 360 deal is good because the label has something to work for. Because if you don't give them a part of the merch and a part of the touring, then what are they going to make money off of? Everything is now, music is free on the internet. I mean, that's where it's going. You still buy songs on iTunes, but even there, it's not being bought on CDs. So CDs are music is going to be promotional. So their only way for them to make money is off your shirts and whatever else you're selling and your music live. So 360 deals are good because it gives the label something, an incentive to put money into you.
Greedy. It never shared. Me being at Motown with Barry Gordy Jr., Smokey Robinson as my writing partner and producing partner, I was very green there. Smokey was vice president. I was his partner. That didn't make me vice president. Stevie Wonder was the first to get his own publishing, because that's where the money really is, in the publishing. Smokey, of course, by being vice president, he gets publishing rights. I had to sign all of my publishing to Jovette. So, you know, record companies, man, you know, the greed.
Well, obviously, I would like to see it change more in the artist's direction, like, as opposed to getting a dime off of every record, maybe a little bit more, or maybe more than a quarter off of each record. And yeah, I don't know. That's about it. Like, maybe the artist making a little more money instead of everybody getting so much of a piece. There's so many people involved. It seems that you don't seem to make much.
Well, the mainstream is declined.
Yeah.
It's all about marketing an individual more than how good the song is.
You don't have to go get a license and prove that you can make music. So everybody's an artist, and because of the internet, everybody's a recording artist, or once they release something. But to become a viable artist, first of all, rock stars are dead. You know, the whole idea of being holier than thou because you make your music, I think people get to see so much of artists nowadays, what kind of people they really are, what do they really represent, what's important to them, what generates their music. It's not just, you know, two articles in a video that you used to see in the 70s, where you thought that your favorite singer just partied and did this and did this. People want to know more about you now. And you can become endearing to people, where you can generate interest into what drives your music and everything else. So be accessible, be unique, find your own signature sound or style, don't just chase the trends, and really learn how to get your music out there, which is just as important. There's a lot of great people that have changed the music business that are not the greatest players or singers in the world, but they have an energy level that people relate to that's completely unique. Mick Jagger's not a great singer. James Brown wasn't a great singer, but they are some of the greatest singers of all times. Just technically, they're not a great singer. So learn how to take your music and move people, not impress them. You know, that's what happened with music in the 80s. It was about guitar players that could impress people. And they learned how to move people, like an Eric Clapton or a Jimmy Page or, you know, Hound Dog Taylor, you know, where just the energy that came forth in their music was completely unique. And not because they could play notes 64 times faster than anybody else. And once you find that signature, and once you find that thing that really can move people, then you really have a shot at expressing your music to large quantities of people, therefore generating a revenue, therefore taking your ideas and concepts to new levels and supporting it with better quality recordings, better quality equipment, you know, more marketing opportunities. And, you know, then you're off and running.
What's more important, shocking or a great musician? I don't know. You can be a horrible musician or a great guitar player. It's how you perform. It's what you put out there.
Okay, so basically, I don't know about the computers and where they came in, and I really don't care, but, you know, I just think that it's done some damage, but it's done some good, too. So, you know, it has up and down to it, you know, good and bad. So, that's really all I got to say.
I think file sharing is great. I'm all for it. Take my CD and burn it for all your friends and do it illegally and you can have everything.
I don't know, maybe the artists will take more control of their own music and have more control of actually releasing their music. Who gets to hear it? The cost of what it's going to cost people. And just have more creative control, you know, over distribution of the music also.
You know, it's not acceptable, you know. Is fine. I know there's a lot of arguments that go both ways, but one of the reasons the business is so fucked up right now is because of the file sharing situation and the internet and so on. And it makes it hard to be able to sell your product, which is something that you put your life into. And I know that music is something that's free expression and so on and so forth, but just like anything in the entertainment business or anything in the art world, people do make their living by doing it, so you need to be able to do that, you know. I love the spirit of everybody going out and having a good time and listening to stuff and getting it for free. I love the idea behind why people are doing it, but at the same time, it doesn't necessarily work for the artist, so that's my take on that.
And they came all the way from fucking Sin City to rock this place for you guys.
I think the music industry kind of went down because of what was going on with the internet, and people started downloading a lot of the music. So, you know, musicians started to struggle and kind of have problems because basically I think where they make their money is off their merch and their CDs. It should be the main thing, and it's kind of moved on to actually having live performances. I don't really know who to blame. It could be a good thing. It just depends on how you look at it, I think. So if bands can come up with different ideas of making money and kind of giving people the music that they want to download and have in a right way, it might actually be a good thing, even though it brings down the sales and kind of makes everything go woo down, but it works somehow.
Companies, God bless them, they have to resort to that these days, since the record business is having to reinvent itself after it's crumbled down here because of digital technology.
Yeah, they're desperate.
You know, which you can't, on a business sense, you can't blame them, but any advice to young indie bands out there? I would say that you're in a better position to control your destiny to where you don't have to sign a 360 deal if you don't need to, you know? And if you market yourself on the internet and do some smart moves, you can kind of be in control of what your future might be than with a major label.
And you have to sell a lot less records to make a living.
The way I relate to the new bands is not very good. I'm not really into the new music sounds. I mean, they're handing me Lady Gaga, and I come from a generation with Jimi Hendrix being like my childhood idol. So it's very difficult for me to relate to people who are like, you know, butt pumping in the air and rubbing their genitals as a way of communicating. It just seems like the music is going backwards. So you can keep all your bourgeois, transgender, twilight, artificial romance. I'd rather go surfing.
Yes and no. I mean, for an independent artist, it has given the independent artist a lot of control to get the product out there. Whereas before, you know, we're depending on the record companies, you know, to get market you and all that. But you know, sites like companies like CD Baby, I think, are great, you know, for independent artists and getting your product out there. So, you know, it can go either way. So it's good and bad.
And I watched it change overnight, basically, from the 80s into the 90s. I actually physically watched it change. I watched everybody get fired and walk down Sunset Boulevard carrying their boxes of belongings. It was like a big train of all the different companies that were folding. And the one that I was involved with, which was Geffen at the time. And since then, it's become a very, very much a corporate-run industry with absolutely no sort of creative nucleus. And for the first time, I think, in the history of the music business, it's actually become where the artist is as corporate or potentially corporate as the actual business itself, which means there's zero creative motivation going on right now. It's really based on money and exposure, and I think that has made it, you know, really pretty ugly at this point. So it'll be interesting to see how it morphs out of that.
If things have changed so much in the last, you know, 10 years with file sharing, internet commerce, straight retail record distribution, that it requires a band to really make some decisions and to get very creative in completely different ways than what's been happening for the last 40, 50 years in record sales. So it's definitely something that is completely changing the face of recorded music and commerce.
I think the business going from CDs to file sharing and or whatever, that event, I mean, obviously if you have computers and people that are good at computers, you're going to have people that can take your music, you know, if it's on the internet, because it's on a site, it's on the web. You gave it to this server that someone could take it. So, I mean, it was, and stealing of music was going to happen. Everyone knew it. When Napster happened, it was like a fire. And then there, it's like you put that fire out, but then there's another one. There's another one. It's another one. It keeps spreading, and there's nothing you can do about it. So I don't know what Metallica was thought they were going to do, but they didn't do shit.
I think if you can sell, I think anywhere from 20,000 or more, if you hit that 20,000 mark, I think you're going to get the attention of labels. Artists have done this in the past. Again, I don't want to, you know, name the names and put them out there on the hot seat, but artists have sold even 15,000. Certainly 20,000 and have signed major record deals as a result of that. So I would say somewhere around that number.
It's a great way to express yourself. It's a great art, you know, and don't let the market, the media, the internet control what you do creatively. You know, just do what you want to do and do it for the right reasons.
Kick all the CEOs out. Get some people from the old school. That's what I find wrong with the music industry today. That's what has really turned everything around. You get kids 21, 22 years old, And like people from my era are like, well, they're old fogies. They, man, nobody wants to hear that stuff. Hey, we had the best music. Our music had lyrics that made sense. Soft, I mean, you know, people, the places that we play now, people say, there's no music like those days when you could dance and you fell in love. That was the days when you could leave your door open. I mean, you know, that was the time when you fell in love. I feel sorry for kids today, 10 to 20 years from now, what's their love song gonna be? Rap? You know, rap comes and goes like that. You know what I mean? It's like, it's so fast. And you know, how can you fall in love with, unless it's a love song of rap, you know, how can you relate to it?
The double-edged sword once again. Let's say you got a badass fiddle player in the studio, and he did a fucking awesome take, 4 minutes of fucking badass ripping, but there's two notes that he fucked up on. On auto-tuning, I can respect just going at and fixing maybe 1 to 5 seconds of a player's, you know, pass. But as far as doing vocals and doing a whole fucking record where they're constantly editing, I'm not into that at all. The sun is just here. The sun is just here.
Let me tell you what it's like to play in LA. Usually, this is a Sunday night. Usually, at 8 o'clock, I would go sing at the Cat and Fiddle. When Kim Gardner, who was in The Creation with Eric Clapton, was alive, he would get me two pints of Guinness for singing one song at the Cat and Fiddle. But since he's been dead 10 years, I haven't even been offered a pint. Then later, I go to the Kibitz Room at Cantor's, where I'm treated as if I am taking everyone's spotlight when I walk in the room when people scream my name. So I hit the stage at 1:45 to 1:55 in the morning, just before closing time at 2, and I never know if I'm going to make it on stage or not, because any faux pas will throw me off the calendar completely, like it did on Halloween. And there I am at 1:55 in the morning. I sing my song. The lights come on. The place is closed. And then I get a corned beef sandwich. And if I ask for a celery soda, they raise the roof. That's what it's like there. Usually, I mean, I don't have it so bad because I put on my own shows and I manage Duchess de Sade and work with lots of bands like King Cotton, and I place these bands. So I don't have it so bad because I know how to package a unit and bring the whole thing to a nightclub so that there's no discrepancy and the night runs smoothly. But 99.9% of the time, the promoter's going to steal all the money, and you're lucky if you get 2 drink tickets. That's the way it is in Hollywood.
If you're a newcomer coming into this thing, the most important thing is to be as smart as possible and to look at things from all different angles and to stop for a second and to pay attention to how things work so that you don't get taken advantage of. You don't get in the habit of being taken advantage of, because at the end of the day, you will get screwed. There's no two ways about it.
Big studios, little studios, it don't mean a thing. If you have a song, I always tell people that, if people ask me about writing songs, and I always say, if you can't play it on an acoustic guitar or on a piano and sing it, then you don't have a song. Because you could take MIA, or you could take, I covered that song, that was a good example because I liked the melody of it. And it's like, if you take that song and break it down to an acoustic, it's D and G. D and G, D and G, and it's amazing. It's just, if you take MGMT their hit song Down, you see that that's just two chords too. And it's like, but it sounds like a hit song on acoustic, so you don't need a big studio, you just need to have a vision, you know, and the best records were made from not having things. That's what makes good music, you know, just, that's what gives it character, you know, just different studios and people that are broke. Like me, I'm a perfect example. Like I was getting evicted, you know, when I made my record, you know, I'd made my whole record in my bedroom, basically. So, and I learned Pro Tools making my record because I wanted to make a record. And that was always a dream, to make my own record. And so I had someone mix it later, but some people might say that my mixes were better, you know, but, you know, you don't really need anything, you just need to have a vision.
Well, if I was 14 years old, then I would have no reference point. To me, my whole world would be an MP3, but if you AB an MP3 against a round vinyl record, or even a CD, a WAV file, you know, quality difference is huge compared to a nice stereo vinyl release. But if I don't know that, because I've never been exposed to it, then my world's like this. But if I know full bandwidth of what rock and roll sounds like on a piece of vinyl, then there is a difference. But one good thing about it, in this random world of random plays, you know, it's easy access to music, as an MP3 is.
Well, grim at best. And I say that knowing full well that people have to evolve in whatever they're doing, or otherwise you're just going to be, you know, left in the dust of what was, because technology, you can't really hold it back. It's going to take over. It's what people want. They want convenience. They want things to be at their fingertips, and they're going to get fat in the process, and that's cool for them. But I mean, I'm not going to be able to stop it, so. And everybody's birthday is important.
What's your hook? What's your particular thing that's going to make you stand out in the marketplace? How do you cut costs on touring? How do you cut costs on recording? How do you be completely financially self-sufficient and generate your own investment capital? You've got into all these things, so it can't just be you're some, you know, creative guy with a guitar anymore. You can't. Because you do your own business now, you really have to understand all the aspects, from legal protection of your music, to recording of your music, to marketing your music, to packaging your music, to creating all the tools, from photos to videos. And where out there in the world you have a demand for your music, and how do you bring that music to that demand?
I think it will probably be looking good because of the technology. I mean, there's a lot of things that needs to be, you know, kind of figured out of how to approach. Same thing, the problem with downloading and, you know, bands not being able to sell as many CDs as they were during the 80s. But at the same time, you know, it's, I forgot your question.
The question was,
I've been talking too much. That's what happened. I'm like, what did I just say?
What's the future of the music industry?
There is no future in the music industry.
Yeah.
There is none.